for the half year, which is on those flyers that you are holding. There are two flyers, one for Citco Limited, the other one for International. I'll just start with Citco Limited and comment a bit on International. Just looking at the income statement for Citco Limited, those numbers are in Zimbabwe dollars with all the distortions of the Zimbabwe dollar, but we'll try and make some sense of it. Just looking at the turnover on the inflation adjusted column, those first two columns, our turnover increased by 55% from 627 million to 975 million. Operating profit increased by about almost 30% from 331 to 405 million. Operating expenses, they increased significantly, largely because of inflation-related adjustments by most suppliers. The increase in the volumes were the major driver for that turnover, as you will see from that small table at the bottom. Our maize volumes increasing from 1,294 for maize to 2,588 metric tons. And so was wheat, wheat and barley, which increased from 4,350 metric tons to 5,311 metric tons. Those were the major drivers. The other item there on the income statement is the net monetary gain. Those inflation on the inflation adjustments to come up with those numbers. Now going on to the revenue there, you will see the major driver was because of the government program on the winter in the low veld, and also the increase in the wheat production by the government. Just looking at the other items on that income statement, the finance costs, you will see from that income statement, the finance cost jumped. If you look at the historical terms, for instance, it increased from just 5 million to 90. It was largely because of the high interest rates on the facilities that we secured during the year. It was really a challenge. It was not a question of what the facilities are costing. It was really a question of availability, as most banks had problems with liquidity. But nonetheless, the interest rates were ranging from 25% to 58%. On the share of associate, profit from those associates, the major highlights on the performance of International, whose performance was quite strong this year. It was a complete turnaround from a loss last year to a profit this year. I'll go into a bit more detail on the performance of those associates. Looking at the balance sheet, the major highlights of that balance sheet are the increase in the borrowings and the inventories. You will see that the inventories increased significantly from 413 million this year to about close to 1.5 billion, if I can see properly there. Those were the major, that was the major highlight on that balance sheet. It was obviously resulted in increase in borrowings, which have increased significantly from 157 million to almost $900 million. Looking at the performance of the major associate, the International, if you look at the performance of on the income statement, revenue almost doubled from 17.7 million last year to 27.9 million. These are US dollars. Operating expenses were very much contained, there was a decrease of almost 5%. Finance costs, they're almost on the same levels as last year. This has resulted in the overall profit increasing from a loss last year of 2.6 to a profit of 2.5. Looking at the revenue for international, the revenue increased from 17.7 to 27.9, like I said. It was largely because of the volume increase, driven by volume increases in mainly Malawi, Kenya, Zambia, and Nigeria. Price adjustments and devaluation almost cancelled out. And looking at those markets, you will see that the major drivers of that increase were Zambia, whose revenue increased from 7.7 last year to 12.8 million this year. Malawi also increased from 4.1 to 4.9. Kenya, 1.9 to 4.1. And Nigeria, quite a significant increase. We are quite impressed with that performance. It's largely because of institutional sales to, on a program that was funded by the central bank there in Nigeria. Looking at volumes, maize is the major driver there, as you will see, in revenue terms, increasing from 16.4 to 21.7. Margins, slight decrease from 52 to 47, largely because of some discounts on the institutional customers in Nigeria, and also the price penetration in Mozambique. Finance costs, like I said, almost the same levels as prior. And then on the balance sheet for international, two major features again, inventories increasing from 19, almost 20 million last year, as at year end, to 28 million. And that has resulted in borrowings increasing from 39 to 43. Of course, there were collections, debtors collections during the period that were almost canceled out with the credit sales for the period. That's how our trade receivables were almost at the same levels as prior. Doesn't mean that there were no collections. There were significant collections, but they were just canceled out with the current credit sales. I think those are the major highlights of the performance of those two entities. I'll hand you over to Morgan now for comment on the operations.
All right, so in terms of the operations, what we've generally seen is that I think as an entity operating in the agricultural space, we have largely been spared by the pandemic. Our industry has benefited from the fact that in almost all the markets that we operate in, agriculture has been deemed an essential service. So we've had no disruptions as far as operations are concerned. Our operatives have been able to get the necessary letters to be on the road and be able to carry on with their activities. And I think it's actually translating into the level of business that we are seeing in all the markets. The demand is very buoyant. We are actually seeing increases in all the markets essentially that we are operating in. Yes, we've had to come up with some drastic business continuity plans to make sure we didn't get affected. And I think the results are showing what has come out of the efforts that we did put in. Just going on to the research side, so as you know, the research is the cornerstone of this business, and we always strive to be releasing new varieties. Our research team this year, they did release a new canola variety called Jazz, which is proving popular with oil extractors. and we are hoping to start commercializing it as quickly as possible. They also did release the first proprietary hybrid sorghum variety in this market, and there were 9 maize varieties that we released. SC423, 437, 553, 557, 559, and then all those in the 6 series with various attributes to address specific farmer needs. We continue investing on the research front. It is our key competitive advantage, and we have to keep coming up with new seed varieties. On the production side, again, production was generally good. We managed to get the volumes that we are expecting to get. We've got adequate stocks to service the demand that we are seeing in the market. We might have 1 or 2 mismatches in terms of varieties, but hopefully where farmers don't get the variety that they were looking for, they can get the next best variety. And this is generally the situation in all the markets that we are operating. You'll see that even though this is a briefing for Seedco Limited, we do cover the businesses under Seedco International, because Seedco Limited is a significant shareholder in Seedco International, holding close to 27-28%. So quite a lot of the income gets influenced by what happens in Seedco International. On the processing side, again, all our plants working generally well. We've been able to make sure that the seed is available on time and placed in the networks on time. In all the markets, we haven't had any major breakdowns, and like I said, the COVID issues haven't been a big issue as far as processing was concerned. On the sales and marketing side, sales regionally 70% above prior year, benefiting from the various government programs. I think those of you who understand our business, you remember that in the first half of the year, it's usually an expense accumulation period. Sales normally do happen in the second half of the year when the rains do come. But this year what we've seen is a very good early offtake in terms of sales. And this is actually continuing in the second half as we speak. So we are very positive about the likely outcome at year end. Just by touching on our development files, so Nigeria is a market that we've been working on for a very long time. And the first few years we're focusing on production, making sure that we get production right. And we've now been able to do that and moved on to the next phase of making sure that the people adopt those hybrids that we are producing in that market. This year, the sales volumes so far, they have actually gone up by almost 400%, and they still have a part of the season to go. So that growth that we are seeing is very encouraging. As we've always said, Nigeria is a very important market. It's a very big market, potentially bigger than all our businesses combined at the moment, and we have to focus on making sure that it continues growing. And what has happened this year gives us a very, it is very encouraging in terms of where we think the business will head in the future. We continue with our activities that we are doing in Ethiopia. There, because when you are trying to get all the necessary licenses and so on, there's a lot of feet on the ground that are needed. And we did get affected by the pandemic in terms of the follow-ups and so on. But now that the lockdowns have started to ease, our team was actually in Ethiopia last week, and we are beginning to gather the pace again. Francophone West Africa, we did formulate a new joint venture with Limagrain. As you know, Limagrain is a big French company, so we want to use their French connection and their knowledge of that area to try and penetrate that market. And it's also a very big market. We are targeting about 13 countries, and the business development in those countries is at different levels, but we think it's a market for the future. The source of the income that we'll be making in the next 5 years, 10 years, will come from the development work that we are doing right now. Angola was a very good market last year. This year it's subdued because the government has been struggling in terms of cash flow. Again, induced by the COVID-19 pandemic and the low oil prices, the government hasn't been able to finance seed purchases, so we've had to sell through the open market, and the volumes have generally been lower as a result. DRC, second half sales very promising. The early sales were a little bit subdued, but now we are seeing some traction there. Mozambique is a market that we were in more than 10 years ago, and we came out, we've gone back, and we are seeing some traction now. A few things have changed on the ground, and we are seeing some increasing demand, both on the vegetable seed and on the maize seed side. Just touching on the SBUs, the business units, Zimbabwe, a very good performance, overall volume growth of about 15% as at half year, and this has continued in the second half of the year. Obviously, the numbers are a bit distorted by the currency issues, but from a volume perspective, we are very happy with the trend that the numbers are showing. The one thing that we've also seen is the regional markets generally were short of a number of varieties of seed. So we've been able to do quite a lot of exports from Zim into the region to service some of our other business units, which is obviously very important for this business unit because of the need to raise foreign currency for our requirements here. I think with what we are doing, exporting a lot of seed into the market, the SBU should be in a very good position as far as foreign currency requirements are concerned. The business unit still carrying on with the construction of the dryer. We are now expecting that to come on stream March this coming year. Again, that was one project that was hampered in a way by the effect on the supply chains of the pandemic. Some of the parts that were needed couldn't get here on time. Zambia, first half sales 31% above prior year, benefiting from an early sales drive and the government of Zambia coming in to place their orders early and us going into the market early, making sure the stockists had adequate stocks. We have been able to sell all the seed that we sold to the Zambian government this year using an LC, which we then were able to discount. So they have essentially been able to pay upfront for that seed. I know that's always a lingering question. People know of the challenges that the Zambian government is going through in terms of their cash flows. Overheads significantly below budget. We know that with the pandemic and with the change in the way we do business, people working from home, reduced travel and so on, we've been able to cut our costs. And the big topic on our minds at the moment is how do we hardwire these savings? We don't want to go back to the old cost levels. If things can be done and we can make profits with reduced costs that we're incurring because of the lockdown, we mustn't go back to the old costs. How do you hardwire these savings and make sure that we continue operating at that level? So that is a big strategic issue that we are dealing with at the moment to make sure we don't go back to the old costs. This is the new normal. Malawi looking very good. Again, as you all know, there's a new government there. We used to say, they used to require about 9,000 metric tons of seed. The new government has upped the demand there to about 24,000 metric tons. And we were really the only seed house that had adequate seed there. Well, not so much adequate seed in Malawi, but we've then been able to send seed to that market from Zimbabwe and Zambia and so on to also meet the demand that we are seeing from that more than doubling of the market size. So we are expecting the business unit to do very, very well compared to prior year in terms of their year-to-date metrics, performance metrics. They are all pointing towards a very profitable year. Kenya had some challenges for the last couple of years. Now it has done a rebound at the turnover. If you compare to prior year, significant increase. Operating expenses much, much lower. The volumes have increased significantly. Last year, it actually made a small loss. This year, we're expecting it to contribute positively. And again, all the metrics looking very promising. Tanzania, numbers very good. We know it's a market that has been growing for the last few years. It's a big country. With still lots of opportunities, still lots of untapped market, still lots of areas that we are not servicing. and the volumes continue to grow. I was talking to the MD in Tanzania yesterday and was saying he had just received a call from the president's office there asking about the seed shortage, certain varieties, and saying what's happening, why are these varieties in short supply and so on. So I think it's a good metric. It shows that demand is there, and it's a good problem to have, to be explaining that, look, we are increasing our production this coming year. This year, we didn't have enough of that variety because the pent-up demand wasn't predicted. And yeah, we see that business continue to grow handsomely. The Common Customs Union, generally doing well. The ISPAT program in Botswana continuing. And what we've done with our businesses in Swaziland and South Africa, we've formed a joint venture with Lima Grain and K2. We are targeting 10% market share in South Africa in terms of the maize seed business as a joint venture. And we thought, let's put our resources together. So a SeedCo will effectively have a 20% shareholding in that joint venture. And the other parties, Lima Grain and K2, will have the balance of the shareholding. On the outlook side, sales in all the markets generally looking good. We think the numbers will be much, much better than last year, particularly on the international market. In the Zimbabwe market, it's always difficult to really know. We know that the numbers will be better from a volume perspective, but currency issues sometimes do come in when you're doing your translations and so on. So you're never too sure where you end up. But generally, overheads expected to be low, volumes to be high, profits to increase, and the year-to-date performance, like I said, what we showed in this first half has continued to show through in the second half. I think the Zim business, when you look at the numbers that they've achieved so far, they should really be able to come up with a very decent performance. The regional businesses, the profit, you saw the profit that was declared at the half year, that should really be increasing significantly in the second half. I then just wanted to spend a couple of minutes on the reconsolidation of the group. You all remember a couple of years ago, we did the unbundle SeedCo International and listed it separately on the Botswana Stock Exchange and left the Zim business on the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange. I think you all recall early this year with the currency issues that happened in the market. First of all, there was a suspension of all counters on the ZSE, and then eventually three businesses were singled out that couldn't trade on the ZSE, SeedCo International, PPC, and All Mutual for perceived currency effects that were arising out of that share. So subsequently, the VFX was established, the Victoria Falls Stock Exchange, and we were requested by the ministry to go and list on that stock exchange as a condition to resuming trading. Now, when you look at the three counters that have been asked to start on the VFX, SeedCo, PPC, and All Mutual, you will see that All Mutual, the share that's going or that's supposed to be going on the VFX, is includes the Zimbabwean operations. PPC, the share that's supposed to be trading on the Victoria Falls Stock Exchange, includes the Zimbabwean operations, whereas the SeedCo International share that's supposed to be going on the Victoria Falls Stock Exchange only covers the regional operations because the Zimbabwean operations were listed separately. So we want to compare like with like on that stock exchange, and this is why we are saying we can't just be trading the international business on that stock exchange, leaving out the Zimbabwean business. For us to be comparable with the other two counters, we also need to move our Zimbabwean business so that we are comparing like with like. Yeah, we have our Zimbabwean business also operating under the SeedCo international umbrella. Obviously, this is early days in terms of how that stock exchange will pan out. We know that there have been a lot of admin issues, particularly from banks. Most investors, when they're used to dealing with one particular bank, to ask them to open an account with another bank becomes a problem. And there are a few banks that have complied in terms of the registration requirements or the admin requirements of the VFX, but some of the international banks have taken a bit of time before they comply, and we think this has had an effect in terms of generally lethargic start to that stock exchange. But also for the group, we think generally getting the business quoted on a US dollar denominated stock exchange is a good thing. You know, I think we were looking at this business a few years ago and adding the two companies at some stage, we were saying it's a $1 billion business, and then boom, the value in Zimbabwe just started going one way because of the currency moves, and all of a sudden a business that's what worth close to $1 billion became worth less than 200 million, and we don't think that's good for investors. Investors, when they have a share that they are valuing at a certain price in US dollars, they want to see that continuing to grow as opposed to being affected by country specific currency issues. And I think all the investors, when they calculate the value of their shares, if you compare them a few years ago with now, because of what has happened to the currency, everyone has lost value big time. So we think that moving the share on a stable stock exchange, this will be good for everyone. And it does fall into line with our long-term plan for the business anyway. So we are, it's a transaction that's currently on the go. We are planning to have the EGM on the 31st of December, and if we get the necessary approvals, hopefully the whole transaction will be consummated by the financial year and 31 March. I think it has various other benefits to us in terms of just simplifying the governance issues of the group, the management issues of the group, the issues to do with running two listings, or now three listings, because you have a listing on the Zim Stock Exchange, a listing on the VFX, and a listing in Botswana. So there is some harmonization and elimination of common costs there. And then we are also able to restore the synergies that were existing in the past in terms of elimination of intercompany balances. Companies are able to trade with each other more easily without worrying about whether these balances will eliminate at year end and so on. And the whole entity becomes one again. This is something that we couldn't do at the time of unbundling, because as you all remember, there were the indigenization laws that had their own specific requirements. So we couldn't do what we wanted to do when we did the unbundling. But now the legislation is supportive of the thought process. We did circulate a circular to the various shareholders. I think people have gone through that circular. It does detail what we are planning to do, the benefits of being on the VFX, and what we hope we will be able to achieve. I will pause here and take questions, or rather end here and take questions. Don't you have questions? We have a roving microphone.
Thank you for the presentation. I just wanted to get some clarification on what to expect in the second half of the financial year. So in the first half, you mentioned about early sales. Mm-hmm. Are we talking about sales that are usually recorded in the second half? And if not, should you expect a continued trend where most of your sales may be up to 66% from the second half of the year?
Well, we are expecting the trend to continue. Like I said, business is very buoyant. In many markets, they are actually asking for more seed. So the demand has been very good. We are expecting some volume growth compared to prior year, significant volume growth compared to prior year. And that's an indicator of where we expect the business to end. The fact that the volumes are growing overall compared to prior year should be an indicator to you that we haven't cannibalized the sales of the first half. The sales that we normally do in the second half, we haven't cannibalized them in the first half. And there has been some very interesting business. For example, this year we got a 2,000 metric ton wheat order from the government of Nigeria. We've never sold wheat seed in Nigeria. And we were actually saying to them, guys, we have never sold wheat in this market. We need to do more trials and so on. But the guys were just saying, listen, we'll take that seed at our own risk. We need the risk. We need to try those varieties. I think a lot of things that have happened because of the pandemic. The world needs to be fed, and it's an industry that has benefited from the pandemic by and large. Many people are not able to do what they would have done, but they need to be fed, and we are seeing that buoyancy continuing throughout for the medium term anyway.
Morgan, I just wanted to ask around your human capital strategy. It appears that you are growing aggressively in Africa. I just wanted to understand, what's the strategy? Do you source people from those markets, or are they from Zim? Are you just shipping, you know, people out of Zim? What's the strategy on human capital? And also, just to talk to the pricing dynamics across these markets, more specifically around maize seed. How does it compare across the markets that you operate in?
Okay, thank you. So on the human capital side, what we've always strived to do is to try and make sure that our businesses are led by locals. You know, it's always easy for a local to go and meet the government officials, to go and meet the key stakeholders in that market. I think if we put a Zambian to come and run the Zimbabwean business unit, he might struggle to go to the Minister of Agriculture every day and open doors and so on. So we understand that the locals understand the local nuances. So we try and make sure that at the top level, as much as possible, we put in locals. So you will see that our businesses in Zambia, in Malawi, in Kenya, and so on, are actually led by locals. And fortunately, in these markets, there are very good people who are doing a good job in those markets. Yes, we do tend to second technical skills from other markets, either from here or from other markets, in terms of research, in terms of production, and so on. And even in terms of finance, we try and send some people that have been in the group for some time. But generally, we try to, over time, make sure that the business is run by locals. It's very, very important from a strategy point of view, particularly for our business, which does deal a lot with governments and so on. They just like to deal with their own people. That's what we find in the seed space. So that's really been our strategy. And then your second question was on pricing. Yeah, so you find that for the new markets, we tend to have a slightly different price. We have a penetration price as we strive to get our hybrids adopted. You'll find that in the mature markets, the prices are obviously a lot better, but I think that's the story with all export businesses. When you are, we usually start our businesses by exporting into those markets, and when people adopt our hybrids, we then are able to start mining the value. And we also have to be looking at the prices that are existing in those markets. You can't just go in with your product, which is a new product, at a very high price. You first of all have to show its performance in the market and swing the market towards your product before you can start aggressive pricing. But generally, as a business, we've always had a policy of trying to increase our prices by at least 5% in real terms in the markets that we operate. Sometimes it's not possible because of certain dynamics, but sometimes it's possible. And so you find that in US dollar terms, in all the markets, we generally usually end up with an increase of at least 3% in US dollar terms. That's how we try to manage our pricing dynamics. Any further questions?
Okay, on your other income, I saw R and D recoveries. I just wanted to get an understanding of those ones on other income.
Okay, so R and D recoveries, as you know, we've got a number of farms where we do R and D, where we are growing crops. Our scientists are growing crops, trying new varieties and so on. And when those crops have been harvested, when they are done with their data analysis and so on, those crops have to be sold. And the income that comes from selling those crops is what we call R&D recoveries.
Going forward, I just wanted to know if the African Free Trade Agreement that's anticipated to become to come into effect next year, if it has any material impact on your footprint in terms of exports and coverage in Africa?
Well, I think, you know, so like any of these trade agreements, they tend to really be more government to government. For our product, people need to eat. We've always been able to penetrate any market that we need to penetrate. As long as there's demand for our seed, we've always been able to export to any market. So yeah, I think it will help in terms of speeding up of movement of goods and so on. But in terms of our business, you know, looking at the number of countries that we are in, I wouldn't say we've had massive challenges trading between borders. And remember, for our major businesses, we're actually producing countries. So we are producing in Zambia and selling in Zambia, we're producing in Malawi and selling in Malawi, producing in Kenya, selling in Kenya, producing in Nigeria and selling in Nigeria. So, because the nature of governments, they always want self-sufficiency in terms of food. They want to be producing in country. They don't want to be importing seed from other countries unless if there's a shortage in that particular year. And that's also part of our strategy, to make sure that in any market that we target, we go and produce locally, process locally, and distribute locally. Any further questions? If there are no further questions, thank you all very much for coming, and thank you for your support coming at such short notice. We weren't too sure when we would do the briefing because of the COVID restrictions, the travel restrictions, and all these things. But I think all we can say is the business is still in a very good space. The numbers are promising. People need to be fed. The growth prospects are good, and yeah, thanks for your continued support. And I think admin wise there must be some snacks somewhere. There must be some snacks we can okay, just behind. Okay, yeah, so there will be some snacks in the room just behind. We can mingle and chat as you eat a piece of meat or two. Thank you very much. Thank you.